Hey everyone, I'm Jean. I am Edee's youngest daughter. Today I wanted to read a letter to you. This letter was written November 29th, 1956 by my grandma Dee to my mom when she was about 1 year old. I wanted to read it today because I believe that it is a prophecy to my mom's life, because her table was never ending. Her arms were always open wide, and everything that she did was done in love for those around her. My grandma so accurately predicted the strength that my mom would have to endure every struggle that came her way and the endless blessings that she would receive as a testimony to the amount that she gave. My grandma Dee wrote, "My beautiful daughter, love is the word that I think of when I think of you. For love describes you from your wonderful birth to the happiness that you have brought me. I feel selfish at times, for I think I love you most because of what you give and make me. I want you to go through life giving love, for the more you give, the more you receive. And a happy life is the result of loving all. Try never to let the seed of hate start in your precious mind. Remember always, it isn't what happens to you in life that counts. The important thing is how you react. Try to always grow strong in heart. I love you very, very much, Mother." Thank you.
Pictures that
I'm
Begins to blow.
Hi everyone, I'm Elaine George. How do I get this puzzle? I've known Edee my whole life. As a child, Mary Beth explained that she was an only child until she was 12. My parents were her parents' best friends, so I was the take-along kid. So that we got into a lot of fun times. My parents couldn't be here today, so they asked me to read something that they put together for all of you. We're all gonna try to get through this together. So, as a child, Edee's loving, playful, giving, and always positive light helped me decide who I wanted to be as an adult. It made a very big impact on me. My parents, Dietamana Rhodes, counted Edee as one of their lifelong friends. It was a friendship that spanned decades. Multiple stages of life, times together, times apart, space when they didn't see each other or even know where each other lived, but miraculously always ended up back together. So my parents wrote this message for you and I'm gonna read it. My name is Dean Rhodes. My wife, Wanda, and I have known Edee since 1977, when Wanda went to a Wayne Ministry Bible Fellowship in Oklahoma City. When they met, Wanda described Edee as bubbling with excitement. Pretty accurate. That is because they had just heard a teaching on the truth and accuracy of the Word of God. That set a pattern for the rest of Edie's life. Eventually, Edee won her entire family and many others to God and to His Word. One of her greatest qualities was reaching out to people that she did not know and loving them with her beautiful heart. She had a very engaging personality that immediately connected her to them. This is the reason she did so well in the petition industry for so many years. Wanda and I worked with her in the petition industry for only about 3 years. And we saw she built great relationships with hundreds and hundreds of people. Edee would set her mind to a goal and drive herself committedly until she reached it. She was involved in the political elections to bring about an outcome that would benefit everyone, the entire country. She would still be out there today if she were here. Edee lived her life fully convinced of the accuracy of the Word of God. Let's read together. Well, I'll read it to you. No, I'll have to read. What the Word says about those who are asleep in death, awaiting Christ's return. This is our hope and comfort. First Thessalonians 4, verse 13 says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that which we are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words." And then in 1 Corinthians 15, it says, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory." Death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor was not in vain. Edee's missed by a lot of people, so many people. But everyone in here can tell you she was steadfast and unmovable. And her labor was not in vain. We look forward to spending eternity together with her at the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you. Probably know my mom loved karaoke. It was one of her absolute favorite things. Every time she came into town, we sang karaoke, and without fail, she asked Mary to sing this song. So
we're gonna have it, guys. This is no regular custom.
Here
we
go.
Overseas, y'all can try to stop terrorism. But we still got terrorists here living in the USA. The CIA, the Bloods and the Crips and the KKK. But if you only have love for your own race, then you only leave space to discriminate. To discriminate only generates hate. When you hate, then you're bound to get irate. That is what you demonstrate. That's exactly how anger works and operates. And you gotta have love just to set it straight. Take control of your mind and meditate. Let your soul gravitate to the love, y'all.
You don't care when people try it. Children hurt and you hear them crying. Then you practice what you preach. Won't you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us. Send some guidance to come above. See the God thing I've been questioning. Where is the love? Where is the love?
Father, 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 help us. Give some guidance from above. bacteria, negative integers, instant criteria, infected young minds, faster than bacteria, kids wanna act like they're seen as a scenario. Whatever happened to the values of humanity? Whatever happened to the fairness and equality? Instead of spreading love, we're spreading animosity. A lack of understanding, not to make the humans see. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling under. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling down. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling under. Not a big black lifestyle.
Something a little different. I'm gonna open the floor up. If anybody would like to just stay in their seat, I'm gonna bring the microphone around. I'm gonna start with one of my mom's oldest friends, Mandy.
I didn't think this would be so hard. Edee and Mary Beth were my roommates for the almost entire very long, long stint in Oklahoma City. And Edee and I loved music and were huge Dan Fogelberg fans.
Yeah.
But she also had her quirky side, as you can tell from the song we just played. And when videos started coming out, and I purposely kept this really wide, a video came out by a new band called Devo, and they had a song called Crack That Whip. And Edee loved that song. We were going to a spasmo dance every time we heard this song. And I listened to an oldie station in my car, and they play this song every day. And the minute I hear the first chord, I just see Edee dancing. And it makes me smile. So I loved her a lot.
Yeah, the 80s were a good time. When Wendy was our roommate, she used to let me go into her room, and she bought me a pair of leg warmers that matched hers, and we would do aerobics to Michael Jackson. It was great. Who'd like to go next? It's just a hand up, and I'll put my leg around.
You never know it. All you knew from her was life. Everyone she met. From the most least memorable dishes to her beautiful daughters. This entire family is my family. She's going to be so missed. Oh, my God.
name is Mary Beth. And for those of you who didn't know, that's my dear sister and good friend, Edee Wright. She introduced herself. Robert McDuffie. And I just wanted to share from my heart that if I could be so presumptuous, I knew my sister as not only a sister of the human race, but in Christ. And I do know that if she was here today, which I know she is with us in spirit, and I do know that I will see her again, as was testified earlier at the resurrection, that she would say three things to us today because they are true. Number one, life is short. It just started yesterday for all of us, and before you know it, it is going to be over for every one of us. And just as we were all surprised to hear the news that she is not here, one day someone is going to be surprised to hear the news that you are not here. The second thing she would say to us is that family is important. If you knew Edee, she made you feel like family, even if you were not blood related. Everyone was important to her. And the thing that I related to Edee about the most was that she had no grudges in her heart. She did not hold on to the offense when she went to bed at night. Every day was a new day, and she released it to the finished work of the cross. She forgave everybody as she had been forgiven through the blood of her Savior, Jesus Christ. And so today I would encourage you that if you are at odds with any of your family or friends, or if you have any offense in your heart, Edee would tell you, let it go.
Yeah.
Family is important, and she lived that every day. And finally, she would say to us that eternity is real, and it is forever. Regardless of what you believe as you sit in your seat here today. And if you want to see her again, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by me. And if you want to see her smile again, if you want to feel her embrace again, then today I would encourage you to loose yourself from the lie. The Father loves you with an everlasting love, and he wants to put his arms around you, and that can only happen by trusting in the Savior, that Jesus, that he trusted in, and that is the one and only Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you've never done that, I encourage you to do that today. If you don't know how to do that, that's okay. God knows that. Just tell him, I don't know what I'm doing. Please help me, and he will help you. If you want me or my wife, Jennifer, to help you, we'll do that to help you too. Thank you very much, sir.
I'm just going to stay seated.
Everybody knows the name McDuffie in the petition roll because that's our last name. And I don't really understand that enigma sometimes. But I've even met people here today and said, what's your name? And when I said, June McDuffie, they said, oh! And I'm like, I'm supposed to know you. You know me, but you didn't know me, but you knew my name. It's kind of how I felt about Edee. Everybody knew Edee and loved Edee. And one of the things I like to share about my memories with Edee is the first time I ever met her, she told me, she knew my husband before we were married. She said, the first time I ever met your husband, I was introduced to him this way. Somebody pointed him out as he was walking across and said, you see that girl out there? And she said, yeah. They said, you go put him in a cornfield, drop him off there, he'll still come back with signatures. She said, that's how I met your husband. Not a lot of people know this story about Edee, but you'll relate to it because she was this way with everyone. But in 2013, at the end of 2013, my husband and I had been doing mission work in South Africa for 3 years. I had come home, and we were been separated for 4 months. Not in the way of separating from one another, separated by an ocean between us. Not something we wanted, but it was a season. We didn't know how he was going to get home. We didn't have the money. This is the first time in 4 years that I've been married to you that we've been apart. And 4 months apart for people that really love each other was hard. And here comes Edee. Don't worry about it, sweetie. I got you. Next thing I knew, my husband had a ticket home, and we were reunited. And I told her, I'll pay you back as soon as we have the money. Her response was, there'll be some work this year. We'll work it out. Well, there was work that year, and we worked. But she would never let us pay one penny back. That was the kind of friend she was. She took care of us all. She loved us all, and she made sure that we knew that she loved us all.
Hi. Hold on. Give me 1 second, y'all. Hi, everybody. Hold on a minute. I'm ready to sit down. I miss you so much. Like, I talked to her 2 days before she died. And, like, she was so excited for her car that she talked to, you know, just about a lot. And she was like a mom to me. Hold on. I told myself driving down to Philadelphia that I would not cry at this thing. But it's just, like, I'm trying so hard right now because, like, she was like a mom to me, you know. I spent some time at Edee's house. And she opened up her home to me in her house in Lawrenceville, here in Lawrenceville, Georgia. And just, hold on a minute. She opened up the house, and then also in Florida. Hold on a minute. I was confident that I was going to speak with this microphone. And I called her, just, she was everything to me, and I love that woman. And Mary Beth, where's she at? I'm like, shoot, right now. And I'm not one to be shy at all. And anybody who knows me, I'm not shy at all. I'm not shy. But I'm holding back so much emotion right now that I don't want to cry. And I'm crying. But I'm working on this thing right now with this whole bunch of memories. One of them, Alita, and Edee. What state were we in, Alita? Help me out.
Huh?
Huh?
Are you talking about Florida?
No. When the RV incident, when me and you and Edee were stuck in the RV, and Edee told me to just, with all your might, kick the door down, and meanwhile, Rick and Russ are outside. I'm trying not. Oh, God, it's like, and I'm like, I'm gonna break your door. And she's like, I don't care, we gotta get out of here. Oh, God. But just, you know, like everybody in this room, she loved every single body, you know? And just, I don't wanna fill up anybody's time, you know? There's so many stories to tell. But I want to give it to the next person. But I have so many stories, and I freaking miss it. I miss it so much.
My voice.
thing I will say about her is that woman lived with no fear. You could tell it by the way she drove. And she's on the phone with Alita. And she's clearly not paying attention. So she flies over at her, pops the tire on my side of the car. And I screamed. And she looked at me and said, "Why did you scream?" Like, I'm the crazy. So, and she took that attitude with her everywhere. And like, no matter where she was going, she knew God had a plan and that it was going to work out despite any efforts against it. When I first spoke to her, I was only 14 years old. And to say that that woman has made an impact on my life doesn't even come close. She was a mother to the motherless, a person who knew how to love beyond bounds. And one time, when I was going through what I thought was the hardest time of my life, but apparently not, because the ball keeps rolling, I had called her, and I said, "I have to tell you something," but I couldn't even find the words. So I'll leave you with what she replied to me with that day. "There's nothing you could ever do to make me not love you. And just remember that, because that's all she knew how to do, was love and everything."
Just like everybody else here, Edee and Alita, actually, Edee and Alita were really my best friends in this whole business. And I met Edee in court. And the way we met is like one of the petition companies had gotten in trouble in Oklahoma. And I hadn't worked there. And they called and asked me if I would be a plaintiff. And when I went to do that, She was one of the expert witnesses. And, you know, that's where we began our friendship. And she was just wonderful. I've got so many memories, just like everybody else. We had a blast when we went to Europe together. We did so many fun things. We went to tea at Kensington Palace. We crossed Abbey Road. You know, we just did so much fun things. And to me, just like everyone else here, the greatest thing Edee did was love. And I mean, she loved with all her heart. And she forgave. And I've seen her forgive people who certainly didn't deserve it. But she would certainly take them back and give them multiple choices. I mean, multiple chances. Mm-hmm. And when we got the news, I can't even hardly begin to tell you the number of people who called me. Girls, women, and men who were just completely torn out because they just loved her so much. Mm-hmm. You know? And I'm looking forward to the day when I see her again. You know, I hope she's up there with my husband. I hope to see them both one day. But I sure did love her.
You will, sure.
Anyone?
Hey guys, I'm Alex Arsenault. I'm here with Harold. We're the people that Edee would work with in Massachusetts on all the ballot initiative petitions up there. I know a lot of you have Matt, even though we've worked on a lot of our projects together, so thanks to everyone that probably has been a part of that. Edee took such good care of all of us. She was like a mother of the industry, right? And she was the best of us. She really was. And she made us see the best in ourselves of how she treated everyone respectfully, kindly, helped people when they needed help, helped pick people up when they were down. I think one thing we can all take away from here is we all are gonna, let's be inspired to work hard and make up for her loss. Because we all need to be kind to each other. Just because she's not there to pick us up doesn't mean we're not there to pick each other up.
That's right.
Let's all remember that.
Yes.
What Edee did, we can carry on in our lives together. And also that Edee, maybe more than anyone in the world, which is saying a lot, but it's not saying a lot when talking about Edee, is she dedicated herself to the honest and diligent and accurate conduct of our democratic institutions, which yes. make this country what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a noble cause, and that is a noble life. I can't think of anything more yep. more to say than that. But
yes.
Thank you all for being here and inviting us here. And mm-hmm. we came down from Boston through this crazy software situation. Yes. So yes. it's inspiring to see this. Thank you.
Hey everyone, this is Rebecca. All of us here were colleagues of Edee and friends, of course. We love and miss her very much. We didn't plan on really talking, but I felt like on behalf of LTV and Mark Jacoby and Big Eye Big World, we needed to come out here and support Edee and her family, who are beautiful people, by the way. I'm glad that Edie's legacy will live on through her daughters, her children, her grandchildren. They're a beautiful family. We got to spend some time at Edie's house back when she was still living in Lawrenceville. She painted it yellow, I think it was, and we were like, why is she painting her house yellow? It was awesome. A great time. Her grandmother made my son his birthday cake, and we cooked a Thanksgiving dinner, and that was just Edie. She was just giving and welcoming, and she was constantly wondering and worrying about us and if we needed help with anything. Funny because we do a lot of things with tech, you know, technical stuff. And she knows so much about the petition industry and so much about working, and the tech questions would come in. She would be so lost, and it was weird to see her lost because it wasn't like her, you know? She knew everything. But as he said, she was the mama bear of the petition industry. She was definitely the mama bear of our, you know, group, our circle. We always had jokes because she was so funny in the group messages. She'd always be an hour late and be like, what I miss? You missed the whole thing, Edee. But it was funny, you know, like we always caught her up and, you know, made her feel welcome, just as welcome as she made everyone else feel. Another thing is she let petitioners live with her, and we were like, what is wrong with her? We never understood it, but like now that she's gone, it's such a beautiful thing that she opened her doors, like her private home, to people who, you know, were doing good work for her and needed that helping hand. And I appreciate her and all of her efforts, and we'll miss and love Edee forever. She's somebody we'll never forget. Big Eye Big World trips will not be the same without her. I remember almost every trip she said, Rebecca, are you gonna go on the trip? I said, no, Edee, someone's gotta stay back and work. And she's like, well, I'm going. I was like, well, I'm not here going. So, like I said, none of the trips are gonna be the same, and the petition industry is not gonna be the same. Our group chats won't be the same, but we love and miss Edee, and we thank you guys for coming. And to her family, you guys are beautiful because of her, and I'm glad that, you know, that shines through. We love you, Mary Beth. I know she did.
Hi, everybody. My name's Marie. Thank you.
and part of Edee's family for petitioning and murdering her family. I lived with her for years. I love Edee to death. I'm Mr. Gregley. You're good parents to her family. I love you all. I hope you have a great day. I just can't tell any more stories. Sorry.
Marie was part of the petition family as well as the Flying Saucer coffee shop family. Some of you may not know that my mom used to own a coffee shop in Lawrenceville, Georgia, and it was amazing. And we have some beautiful friends that are here and just lifelong friends. We love that.
Hi, my name is Rebecca Coyle. Edee was there for me so many times when I just needed an ear to listen to. Someone to talk some reason into me. Sometimes snatched me by my head and said, no, young lady, you're going to do this. And she's one person I did not argue with. Thanks to her and this beautiful woman, Sherry, sitting next to me, are two of my biggest mentors. And two exceptional women that I honestly looked up to. And who reminded me on a daily basis that, young lady, you're worth it, you're loved. That put your best foot forward, and if you don't, I'm gonna kick you. So, she had given me a table. And it looked a lot smaller at her house than it was mine. And I built a garden around it, and it's affectionately named the Garden of Edee, and it's lit up with stars, and it's got all kinds of plants. And I was so looking forward to that cup of coffee that we were supposed to have when she got back. I texted her that morning, and I told her I'm ready to go unpacked. And she said, I'm booking your ticket. 3 hours later, I got a different phone call. To say, shocked, anguish. Wondering if things could have been different had I left a week before. But I will continuously cherish her garden, and I sit back there, and when I make my coffee, I will have one for her. There is a plant that's out front, and every single one of them is in that garden. And Mary Beth, thank you so much for everything you've done.
Hi there, I'm Harold Helpshun. Some of you know who I am. I work with Alex in Massachusetts. I've just been listening to all of these stories that people have. I remember vividly the day and the moment that I met Edee for the first time. We were working on, we had a job in Massachusetts, in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Late fall of 2010, I had met Alida a year earlier, and she had helped us on a project. And I had heard Edee's name in the industry for many years and hadn't met her. And so we had this small project. We brought Alida and Edee in to help us. And we met on Mass Ave in Cambridge in front of the Five Brothers Burger Place. And Alida introduced her, and Edee gave me a big hug, and she was genuinely excited to meet us. And this was somebody who I knew as an icon even then in the petitioning industry. This is 14 years ago, and I was very excited that someone like her is taking us seriously. Edee and Alida have worked for us on virtually every big job we've had in Massachusetts since then. We have a third partner who physically could not travel to be here today, Jim Fleming. And the three of us, when we're planning now, we're lucky we can do big jobs. When we plan jobs now, we always say to each other, if it's something that we're worried that we can pull it off and we're just trying to build what we can build, we would say to each other, well, one of us would say, call Edee, find out what she can do, because we knew if she's there, we can pull it off. And our metric was always, we would be sitting there and said, well, we may need other people to help us, but we would say, and we'd start evaluating the other potential crews that we could bring in, and we would always say, well, they're not Edee and Alita, but they should be able to give us what we need. That is the metric that we used. We compare them to Edee and Alita and ask ourselves, how close can they get? And so Edee was a very special person. I feel very privileged to have known her. And it was a very big loss for us all.
My name is Linda Ballard, and I've known the Baggett family since 1994, and I just want to say that I love everyone in this room, that you took your time to come here, and it's such a wonderful, wonderful friend of mine. She has called me 14 in a row because I introduced her daughter and husband. But truly, she was on a fork in the road to learn to love better. And like no other person, she connected the Word of God through her family, through her work. She just knew no bounds. And she truly believed in the love of Jesus Christ. And one more time, you need to tell everyone in this room that I love you. And thank you, Jeannie, for reading that letter, because she truly was love.
Is everybody here? Online, we've all been touched by Edee's love. When I think of our lives, we don't have a circle, spirit influence. As you can see, she's was huge. See how she's touched. And this is what gets every time, even after I heard the news, seeing how she touched everybody in her life that was her calling. So hearing all these stories and thinking of her, it's making me think about my own sphere of influence and how I can do that. And I encourage everybody, if you have been touched by me, look at your circle, your sphere of influence.
Yes.
See, find that diamond in the rough, find that man in the tomb, invest in him, change him or her's life. Love them like she's, love Christ as she's ever done how, and you, and continue to expand our spirit of influence. Just expand it. That's what I just want to encourage everybody. It's just a lot of people. I'm almost sleeping. That's influence people. Share that love, because that's the truth of the Bible.
That's my husband. I'm going to try to not cry. So I have a memory of one time we went to Disneyland, and she was using one of those it's like an electric wheelchair that has a basket in the front. She's riding one of those things, and it says, "Do not let children sit on these with you." So guess what we did? She put me on the lap. And that's, I think, one of my favorite Disneyland memories.
have. Actually, when I wasn't sitting on her rock, I was sitting like in between her legs, so that she said that she put me there so that no one would see me. And I just think it's funny when she's like, "No, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. Come on, we can do this. No, we'll see. No, no, we'll mind." Yeah. So just like two short things. So like when she was very confident. Like I think a lot about how her house in law school was. Like when she started renovating, and she put this tile in her kitchen. It was like the pattern of a soccer ball. Like it was like white and black polka dots. And then I remember, I don't know if it was the cabinets of the walls or if it was like two of the walls, but like it was like ketchup red and mustard yellow. And her bedroom was this like Pepto-Bismol pink. And the reason she loved it, she was obsessed with it. And nobody could tell her that it didn't look good. She was like, "Well, I like it. It's my house." Like she loved it. That was just, I don't know, she was very confident in that kind of stuff. Like, well, you don't have to like it, I like it. And then I remember it was the first time when I was a kid that I ever went with her, like, by myself in competition, because, like, we would travel around a lot with her, but Ellie and I went with her to Arkansas one time. I don't remember how long we were there, but we were really young. I would say probably, like, 7, 10, like 8, 10 or something. And Ellie had a birthday while we were there. And it was in this phase of life where Ellie was really obsessed with like purses and little trinkets and stuff like that. And Grandma took this walkie-talkie and she like put batteries in both of them, but she took one and she told me to wrap it up. And we didn't have like wrapping paper, so I'm pretty sure I just wrapped it in like a piece of newspaper. And she was like, "I'm gonna go in the bathroom and just pretend like I'm in the bathroom. I'm gonna go in and I'm gonna talk into the walkie-talkie." And she goes into the bathroom and Ellie's like, "Am I supposed to open this yet?" And I was like, "Yeah, Grandma said you can open." So she like opens it up and it's just one walkie-talkie. And she's like, "Oh, it's just one." And she starts talking into it. She's like, "Hello, hello, I'm in here. Open me next, open me next." Like, she was, I don't know. I just remember that.
I wrote something, and Edee knew I was tender-hearted, so she will forgive me for having my sister to read it.
I tried.
I tried practicing in the mirror like she told me to, and I just kept crying for an hour or so. So that's why I'm not reading.
I'm Daniel, John's my sister, and it is my privilege to read his heartfelt words to you from his heart to you. We're here today to honor an angel we were fortunate to borrow from God for a time. I met Edee several summers ago in Seattle, Washington. I was trying to decide where to work, and I asked a friend, J.J. Asperius, that he recommended. Without hesitation, he said, "Go to Washington. Edee Baggett has a job and I know she'll love you. If you kill it, she'll take you to Massachusetts and that's the best place to work anywhere. But you'll have to kill it and you'll be her golden boy. And then you can ask her if I can come with you there." So I drove to Seattle and met her. She gave me a big warm hug just as she did, as everyone freaks into her hotel room to get their instructions and paper. What a presence she had. I have never seen such genuine love and care for so many people in one room. Well, I killed it that summer, and I was invited to Massachusetts. And for the past several years, I've learned more about her faith in God, her patience, her kindness, and her walk with Jesus. Edee loved to sing, and she knew thousands of songs that she would randomly start singing throughout the day. Oh, boy, could she dance. From travels all over America to Hawaii, her most favorite place, to Jamaica and Cancun. She danced her way to the next job, and she never failed one. Yes, Edee was successful in every job she touched. Edee lived three lifetimes in one. Her mission in life was to help any and all in need. She has moved on now, and to tell into the hundreds of people that call each month for counsel, I believe she taught you well. So the next time you want to pick up the phone for advice, just take a deep breath, say a prayer, hear her calming voice, and ask yourself, what would Edee do? Find rest, O my soul. In God alone, my hope comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. Psalm 62:5-6. Edee loved Jesus, and most importantly, she lived her Jesus. We have all been touched by an angel. I will always and forever love her.
She was the most vocal person. It does not matter what problem she was facing. She found a way. She never showed stress, right? She just, okay, this is a problem. And she thought about it and she got through it. And it doesn't matter what the outcome was, she made it work. I don't know how to phrase this. Grandma was, in the words of Martha Berry, polite and persuasive. She got whatever she needed. If she needed to call a customer service rep to fix something about a flight or a hotel or whatever, you know, customer service reps are, they can be tough to talk with sometimes. But somehow she always found a way to get what she needed. And she did it by making them feel seen and making them feel loved. A customer service rep that she had never met in her life, never seen in person, right? They're talking over the phone. She found a way to make them feel seen and known and loved. And I swear, that's a superpower.
Yes.
sorry, I'm struggling over here, so I will just finish with thank you all for coming, and thank you all for sharing how much my grandmother made you feel loved. And let's just all try to love like Edee.
Hi, my name's Anafa, and I met Edee got divorced in 2019, moved to California and to try a new life, and asked if I could join him for petitioning, and Edee approved it, and I ended up working, meeting Mary Beth, and then I got offered to go to Nebraska and continue working, and that's where I first met Edee. I think we were in Starbucks in Omaha. And I just left her, said, hey, it's nice to meet you. Thank you for letting me continue to work. And she said, you really impressed my daughter, and she had a lot to say about you, and that's really big to me. So yeah, welcome along. And next thing you know, like weeks later, Edee picks me up from my apartment, and we go to downtown Lincoln, and she's like, let's buy hair bows together. And I was talking to her about, like, how, you know, being tall and having, you know, a vocal cord issue, I was always uncomfortable, like, being pretty. And he said, never stop being beautiful as you are. And she's like, I really appreciate it. And she can see I'm wearing hair, but I don't care about anybody else.
My name's Chris. If I can think of one word that describes Edee, it would be saintly. After watching the Republican National Convention for the last week, I cannot understand how somebody could remain uncorrupt while working in politics. She just, I remember being my first job in Missouri, the Tom Lucky thing, and I was just this kid from Southern California, first job, terrifying about working in the Midwest. So warm, so welcoming. And I just remember thinking, oh, this is, must be the way in which everybody from the South is like. Well, she can, the people who she surrounded herself with made a real impression upon me, upon everybody, everybody here. As a piece of her inside of us. And I'm just gonna close by saying something which really Dr. Belger's announcer, Vince Gulley said, don't be sad that something's over. Be smile that it smiled that it happened.
Yeah. That's right.
That was a microphone you said.
I love Edee.
But not enough. You know, I look at you. And what's cool is, you know, I know God. And you know, and the love from her flowed into you, and it's in you, and I can see the love of her in you, her life in you. You're wonderful people, beautiful people.
Thank you.
You have the love of her inside of you.
And it's awesome, you know,
this nice thing.
I wrote a song last night. I want a song.
I told her that I'm sure he was gonna have him here.
Oh, probably. I love all you people.
And you touched her life so much too. I mean,
open hearts torn to a world without you.
Now all who know
Pride.
Broken. Sad angels singing, yet we're left alone. Why have you gone? God bless you. Amen.
I'm going to try to piece together two pieces of scripture. I'm going to go with, to whom much is given, much is required. And I'm going to borrow a couple pieces from a parable about a sower, seeds, and soil. I'm just going to put this in the blender and see what happens. Okay, so we had a beautiful sower named Edee, who was given a bag full of seeds called love, and she decided to plant it in every one of us that she saw fit as soil, never judging, just planting away. And I did get a little joke from the Holy Ghost when somebody mentioned a garden back there, so I appreciate that. Shout out to the gardeners.
Mm-hmm.
Let's work in that garden of Edee. I'm Edee. So I want to challenge everybody to work in that garden, to continue to nurture those seeds of love that were planted in you. And as those seeds continue to grow and to blossom, may you harvest those seeds and place them in that beautiful bag full of love, and decide to move forward and to spread those into the soil that is barren, unseen, forgotten in the distance, and oftentimes looked over, because that's who Edee was. She was a lover, a giver, and boy, did she have a lot of seeds, because of course, to whom much is given, much is required, and she met the task, did an outstanding job. Love you, Edee, for everything you've done for us, for our family, and may your seeds continue to grow, blossom to those beautiful flowers and bloom. Love you. Say that. Go ahead, say how much you love it.
Thank you, everybody, for coming up.
All right. I think we hear that it's raining outside, and I'll just take that as a sign from God that we can just water those seeds and keep it going. All right. I love you guys. Thank you for being here. Thank you for bearing with us through the tears. We've got some food out there. Please feel free to grab some food. We've got a few tables in here. If you're talented, you can just eat in the seats. The church allows us to eat in this room, so it's totally fine. Get some food and just continue to share your joy, your stories, and just remember, share it, just all the joyful things that you can remember about her. Because that's what today's about. We're celebrating the life that she lived. And I love you guys. We'll just pray and close it up. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for this day. Thank you for every person that's here. God, I lift up everyone who was not able to make it today but wanted to be here, and I thank you for just healing their hearts as well, God. Thank you for the gift, my mom. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Thank
you. That's how you do that there.
A little more tonight.
sign up.